This is the message we have heard from him and proclaim to you, that God is light and in him is no darkness at all. But if we say we have fellowship with him while we walk in darkness, we lie and we do not practice the truth. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of his Son cleanses us from all sin. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say we have not sinned, we make him a liar and his word is not in us. My little children, I'm writing these things to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. He is our propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. Father, that you would come this morning and you would bring illumination on your word, that your word would transform us once again, that it would have its intended purpose. Holy Spirit, do what only you can do in our hearts and our minds today. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Please take your seat. And so as I said, last week we looked at how John, in affirming both the deity and the humanity of Christ, he struck a blow at these people that he referred to as antichrists, right? Imagine calling someone, you know, who used to be part of your congregation saying they were antichrists, but strong words for what was going on. These former members of the Church of Ephesus who were seeking to restate Christ and his gospel. And right, part of this heresy that they espoused was not just questioning Christ's humanity, it was also a denial of the gravity and even the reality of sin. And John begins in his epistle to affirm the reality of sin in relation to the believer. And this forms yet another test for those who would identify themselves as disciples of Christ. And I preached last year, the end of last year, how do you know that you are saved? And I talked about, there's lots of different tests, but John gives three in his gospel. And this is one. One of them surrounds sin and sin in the life of those who identify themselves as Christ's followers. And so we go to verse 5. It says, "This is the message we have heard from him and proclaim to you." You see, John is not just appealing to the ultimate authority, saying, "God said this, God said this." He's actually, although he believes that, he's actually talking as an apostle to his readers and proclaiming, "Hey, you know, this message that I'm sharing, that I proclaim to you, I actually heard this firsthand. This isn't coming down a chain of people. I actually witnessed this as an apostle. I heard it firsthand from Christ." And so he goes on to say this: "This is the message we have heard from him and we proclaim to you, that God is light, and in him is no darkness at all." And I think each and every one of us would be familiar with this idea that, you know, God is light, or God being the light. In John 8:12, Christ says of himself, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." And in Scripture, we often see this repeated contrast between both light and dark, right? All that is light, you know, is God's truth. And darkness we see as sin and separation from God. And I think this is perfectly illustrated in that verse I just read, John 8:12. But beyond this, you will find that light is another designation that is given to God. In other words, it's another name by which he is known. And it speaks of his attributes of holiness, purity, and moral perfection. There is no darkness in him at all. And church, let me remind us this morning, because I'm sure you all know this, but we serve an infinitely holy and an infinitely pure God who is light, fully pure, fully holy, and the very essence of truth. James 1:7 reminds us, "Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow due to change." I want to encourage you, Let no one ever tell you that God is anything other than morally perfect. He is light. Let no one ever tell you that God has some truth, right? Or rather, is a truth. Instead, remember, he is truth. He is the embodiment of truth. And let no one ever tell you that God has ever been contrary to this at any point, or will be in the future. Because by his very nature, he is immutable. And I've said this before. If you don't remember what that word means, it means unchanging. But not only unchanging, it's actually someone who is unable to change. And God is unable to change in line with his perfect nature. And I tell you what a great hope this is for us, church, that we serve an unchanging God. He is not fickle. He does not change his mind. He does not wake up in a bad mood with us on any given day. He remains faithful and constant and unchanging. And so verse 6 continues, if we say we have fellowship with him while we walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. And so, remember, the people that the Apostle John was writing to in his epistle, they were attempting to restate the Christian message. And they claimed entitlement, right? They claimed this new and correct understanding of Christ and a new and correct understanding of sin. And we see this in this day and age, right? We see this in progressive Christianity creeping into the church, this restating of Christ, the Christian message, and, oh, we've got a new understanding about what sin is. But John sets the record straight here. And he says, if anyone is to say that they have fellowship with God, if anyone would say that they are a bona fide disciple, saved by grace through faith in Christ, partakers of communion with the Father and an eternal inheritance, and yet this person then walks in darkness, this person is lying and not practicing the truth. An evidence of genuine salvation, church, an evidence of genuine regeneration and ongoing sanctification is that we would not walk in darkness. And so what does John mean when he says walking in darkness? Is he talking about committing sin? Should we as believers be going and sinning no more? Right? I think we would agree. But if we sin, does this mean that we lie and do not practice the truth according to 1 John? And I know that to us, right, this is incongruent with reality, because we know that there is only one who is sinless. There has been only one. There will be only one. And there is not one sinless Christian here today. So what does it mean to walk in darkness? And I want to unpack this a little bit. I want to go back to, I looked at so many of my cross-references that I'm using this morning, and they're from the Gospel of John, same author. And it's great. Let me read to you John 12, 34 to 37. It'll go up behind me as well. So the crowd answered him, speaking of Jesus, we have heard from the law that the Christ remains forever. How can you say that the Son of Man must be lifted up? Who is this Son of Man? So Jesus said to them, the light is among you for a little while longer. Walk while you have the light, lest darkness overtake you. The one who walks in the darkness does not know where he is going. While you have the light, believe in the light, that you may become sons of light. Let me read verse 36 again. While you have the light, believe in the light, that you may become sons of light. And this is such an incredible thought. But church, it's not just a thought or this pie in the sky image. Rather, this is a reality for us as believers. Jesus said to those who are listening, and he says the same thing to us today, whilst you have the light, Jesus, the embodiment of truth with you, believe in the light. And why? So that you may become sons of light. Sons of truth. Sons set apart, holy as he is holy. Church, if we have fellowship with God, if we've been saved by him, we are united to him in light. We have become sons and daughters, you know what I mean by sons. We have become sons of light. We are transformed, and we are being transformed to be like Christ. And when this is the case, as sons of light, I want to tell you this morning, it is impossible as a son of light to walk in darkness. Verse 7, but if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. All right, so if we walk in the light as Christ is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. And not just with one another as in fellow believers, but fellowship with God. And here's what issues from this relationship. The verse tells us, the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. How amazing that that is a reality for the sons of light. Verse 8 and 9, if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So I want to note this here, just in case there's any confusion. Sin, it still occurs in the light. This is what John's saying. You know, those of you who are sons of light, you shouldn't say that you have no sin. In fact, to make that claim actually shows that you would be deceived, and more than being deceived, you actually have no fellowship with Christ. The truth is not within you. And strong words, but from John, God breathes. And so we ask ourselves the question, what evidences a son of light and separates them from that person who is walking in darkness? Verse 9 gives us a crucial answer. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And so as someone who has been saved by grace through faith, church, you enjoy fellowship with God and you are a son and daughter of light. So therefore, when inevitably you will sin, because that's a reality, we know that, John knows that, John tells us that, but when we end up sinning, remember this, as sons of light, we are able to see sin for what it is. You see, church, in the darkness, things are hidden and concealed, but in the light, everything is seen for what it is. Sin has nowhere to hide. There is no confusion about its nature when it is brought into the light, or where it leads, or what it seeks to accomplish. As sons of light, through the indwelling of the Spirit, we are able, church, to see our sin for what it is. Right? The allure, the attraction gets laid bare in the light. The Holy Spirit brings conviction of our sin, according to John 16. And unlike the one who would walk in darkness, who loves sin, who is indifferent to its destruction, and who lacks godly remorse when committing it, instead the sons of light grow in their hatred of sin as the Spirit sanctifies them. They see it for what it is. And I'm not saying that as a son of light, you never sin and you never find pleasure. But what does Scripture say? Pleasure is fleeting. The pleasure of sin is fleeting. Ultimately, the son, the daughter of light, end up hating their sin the way God hates sin. And they grow in that. Spurgeon said this, if Christ has died for me, ungodly as I am, without strength as I am, then I can no longer live in sin, but must arouse myself to love and to serve him who has redeemed me. I cannot trifle with the evil that killed my best friend. I must be holy for his sake. How can I live in sin when he has died to save me from it? I cannot trifle with the evil that killed my best friend. Wow. This is how sons of light think and walk. I can't trifle. I cannot mess around. I cannot embrace in any way the evil that killed my best friend. So as a son of light, when we inevitably sin, we see our sin for what it is because we are in the light. And we are walking in the light. But the great thing is we don't stop there, right? The next thing, sons of light, is we confess our sins. In Psalm 32 verse 5, David writes this, I acknowledge my sin to you, and I did not cover my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the iniquity of my sin. A recognizing and acknowledgement of sin made possible because we are walking in the light. And if we weren't in the light, church, we wouldn't be able to see our sin for what it truly is. And as sons of light, there is no attempt to cover it up, no attempt to deny its presence. As the light lays everything bare, we take ownership and accountability for what we've done. Instead of hiding things, there is a confession of transgression, a confession of our sin before the Lord. And to confess, I don't know what you think of when you hear that word confess. I know a lot of people, if you hear confess, they immediately think of Catholicism, you know, like the confessional booth. It's not what really I'm talking about here. You see, to confess means to admit or to declare oneself guilty of what one is accused. In other words, through the Spirit indwelling inside of us, we hold up our sin and call it out for what it is. Sin. Right, this isn't like a confession that just leads to self-pity or self-loathing. That's not what Scripture is talking about. The confession is, I've sinned, I've transgressed against the Holy God. And that's exactly what it is, it's sin. Instead of trying to cover it or to hide it. A mark of a true believer is not that they are sinless. Of course, true believers should grow in holiness as they are sanctified. But rather, a mark of a true believer is that their life is marked by continual confession and repentance of sin. This, church, is an evidence of salvation. The genuine believer who is empowered by the Holy Spirit recognizes it, they take responsibility for it, they repent of it, they forsake it, and they abandon that which brings death. That word sin comes from the Greek word hamartia. Some of you might know this. It translates to miss the mark. But if you just took it at phrase value, I guess what I've just said, there is a danger that you'll end up with an incorrect idea. And it is not missing the mark in the sense of there's a target and I'm shooting an arrow and I just miss the bullseye. So I do pretty well. I've just kind of missed the mark that I was aiming for. That is not a correct kind of picture that we should describe to this word and its meaning. More so, imagine you're running to jump across some sort of chasm and you can't see the bottom, right? And you jump. Even if you almost make it to the other side, you miss the mark, you've fallen. Speaks of the gravity of the situation, the gravity of our sin. When we miss the mark, it's not something inconsequential. Because if we fail to repent of our sin, it leads to death. And not just that, church, habitual sin, right? Patterns of sin and a lack of repentance is evidence, according to John, that we are walking in darkness, are deceived, and do not have fellowship with the light. And again, I know that's strong words this morning, but that is the truth. Someone who would say that they are a disciple of Christ, one of his followers, and yet lives, not wrestles, not who is slowly and surely being sanctified and all this, but someone who lives in a habitual pattern of sin and who is unrepentant, is not a son of light, according to 1 John. They are walking in darkness, they do not have fellowship with the light. But the good news is, those who are sons of light, those who have fellowship with God, they will not habitually sin. For a few reasons. Firstly, because they have an ever-growing love for the law of God. Let me read you a few scriptures. Psalm 119, 47-48. For I find my delight in your commandments, which I love. I will lift up my hand towards your commandments, which I love. And I will meditate on your statutes. Again, same psalm, verse 97. Oh, how I love your law. It is my meditation all the day. Psalm 1, verse 2. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night. Romans 7, 22. For I delight in the law of God in my inner being. Man, how often, you know, how we approach reading scripture as a box-ticking exercise, as a joyless exercise, and yet you look at the experience of men and women in scripture. For I delight in the law of God in my inner being. And you get the picture, church, the sons of light grow in their love for the law of God. That which is truthful and just and righteous and holy good. Those who have fellowship with God, they will not habitually sin, because this is incompatible, church, with the work of Christ. 2 Corinthians 5:21 tells us, for our sake he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. And this is the reality. As sons of the light, we are being continually sanctified. And we may sin, or we may hamartia, we may miss the mark, but we confess our sin, we repent of it, and we continue on to look more like Christ, a little bit more each day. Church, it is an impossibility that we would remain slaves to sin whilst having fellowship with God. If you're a son of light, as 1 John tells us, it is impossible that you would remain a slave to sin. And yes, as I said before, we wrestle. And yes, sometimes we fall and we sin, we mess up. But ultimately, we will walk in victory, because the battle has already been won by Christ's work on the cross. Those who have fellowship with God won't habitually sin, because it is no longer in their nature to. 2 Corinthians 5:17. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away, and therefore the new has come. This new nature loves God, and it hates sin, and it grows each day to love God more, and by default, therefore, to hate sin more. And John addressed those holding to the heresy that would say, I am enlightened, I am walking in the truth, all whilst denying the reality of sin, failing to recognize it in their own lives, and evidencing it by walking in darkness. This is who he was addressing. But not so the sons of light. As the son of light, when we inevitably sin, we see our sin for what it is, because we are in the light. We confess our sin to God. And this is the great news for us all. When we confess our sins, we are cleansed. The end of verse 9 says, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And what a comfort that is, and what a reason to rejoice. No banishment. No having to earn his favor for 3 to 5 business days before we can somehow come back maybe to fellowship with him. But rather, a son of the light, when they sin, they see their sin for what it is, they confess it to God, they are forgiven and cleansed completely by the blood of Jesus, and they continue to walk in the light. Verse 10 says this, if we say we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. Isaiah 53:6, all we like sheep have gone astray, we have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Psalm 14, verse 3, they have all turned aside, together they have become corrupt. There is none who does good, not even one. Romans 3, 23, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. I'm sure you get the picture. All have gone astray, all have turned aside, all have become corrupt, none do good, all have sinned. And anyone who would say anything otherwise would, by their admission, seek to make God holy and the truth, they would seek to make him a liar. We are all indeed sinners and in desperate need of a Savior. And when you realize your position, church, outside of Christ, as someone who is once in the darkness, who was walking in darkness, when you realize that was where you were, how much more so is there cause to rejoice when we realize the reality of what Jesus has done for us. 1 Peter 2:9, but you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for his own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness and into his marvelous light. Out of darkness, out of sin, out of deception, into holiness and truth. That is where the sons of light find themselves. This is why the true believer, the one whose heart has been regenerated, doesn't recoil at the mention of sin. Do you ever think about that? We sing some of these old hymns, and if you, I mean, I'm sure many of you grew up singing a lot more than the catalogue that we sing here at ICC, but a lot of these hymns speak about sin and speak about, you know, our position outside of Christ. And the words are, it's not like I once missed the mark, but I did pretty good because I'm good kind of on my own, but then Jesus came and he gave me a bit extra. It wasn't like that. It was, you know, just amazing grace, how sweet it sounds, but say the wretch like me, right? A wretch. You ever refer to yourself as a wretch? But when your heart has been regenerated, like us, like these men and women of old, there was no shame in talking about sin. I didn't try and shy away from sermons about it, or hearing about it, or talking about it, because this was the amazing thing. They were able to see the gravity and the magnitude of this sin, and how lost they would have been outside of Christ. And their heart was filled with joy and with gratitude when they were reminded about the work of their Saviour. And I don't mind reflecting about the time where I once walked in darkness, because now I am a son of light. And that gives me reason to rejoice. It gives me a reason to praise. John continues in chapter 2, verse 1. And so remember, even though it's now chapter 2, it's sort of being just one continuous letter. Right, he says, "My little children, I'm writing these things to you so that you may not sin." And I don't want to be confused here, and neither did John. Because although he's just told us that those who walk in the light are not without sin, does that mean that we are given a license to sin? The Apostle Paul talks about this as well, remember? He poses a similar question to his readers, Romans 6, 1 to 2. What shall we say then? Are we to continue in sin so that grace may increase? May it never be. How shall we, who died to sin, still live in it? Skip forward to verses 12 to 14 of Romans 6 as well. Let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body to make you obey its passions. Do not present your members to sin as instruments for unrighteousness, but present yourselves to God as those who have been brought from death to life, and your members to God as instruments for righteousness. For sin will have no dominion over you, since you are not under law, but under grace. And this is the greatest news ever. Church, that the sin crusher came not only to deal with the penalty of sin, and one day he will deal with the presence of sin, but he came to deal with the power of sin as well. Through the power of the Holy Spirit, you don't have to resign yourself to a life of constantly being beaten down by sin. You are not powerless against it, not because it's in your own strength, but because you have the Holy Spirit dwelling inside of you. And I thought about this. Our Christian life should not be like sinning Groundhog Day. Has anyone seen that movie, Groundhog Day? Right? That's not how God intended for us to live. Where we commit the exact same sins in the exact same way every single day, get to the end of the day and go, "Lord, sorry, I really missed the mark today," and then repeat it all over again, exactly the same, every day, every day, and every day, until you one day die. No! No, he came to break the cycle. He came to break the Groundhog Day cycle, church. As you grow in maturity in your love for God and his word, you will sin less. You will not be sinless, but you will sin less. John is saying, I write all of this stuff to you, ultimately so that you would not sin. And I love this, because not to leave us discouraged or dismayed, he continues in loving reassurance. He says, but if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. Church, we have an advocate. In the Greek, that word is parakletos, or the paraclete. And it comes from two words, para, meaning close beside, and kaleo, which means to make a call. And together we get this beautiful word that means someone who has been called to our side to plead our case. And I was trying to think, you know, with the meaning of the word, this is probably the closest illustration for us. Picture yourself, right, being on trial for crimes that you've committed, and Satan is prosecuting you. And the evidence is damning. You are guilty, right? He doesn't even have to lie about you. He's just presenting the facts. You're certainly done for, right? There's the just judge, which is God. He is completely loving and completely just, but he's holy in both aspects. And all seems lost for you. But all of a sudden, the world's greatest defense attorney is called to your side. And not just called to your side to stand there and give you the thumbs up for moral support. He's called to your side to plead your case. And he does so by saying to the judge, "Judge, though he has sinned, my righteousness has been imputed to him, and the debt has already been paid." Church, when we sin, which we will, we have an advocate with the Father. All is not lost. And because of Christ's work on the cross, we have been made legally right before a just judge. We've been acquitted of our sins. Colossians 2, 13 to 14 tells us this, "And you who were dead in your trespasses and the uncircumcision of your flesh, God made alive together with him, having forgiven us all our trespasses by cancelling the record of debt which stood against us with its legal demands. This he set aside, nailing it to the cross." How amazing is that? The record of debt that stood against us with all of its legal demands, right, was cancelled by the work of Christ. He took it and he nailed it to the cross. And 1 John 2 verse 2 tells us this, speaking of Christ, "He is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world." And I love that word, even though I struggle each time to say it, propitiation. And I'm trying to teach Micah and Judah, and it's probably going to take us a year. But as much as I like to say it, we only actually find that word, that exact word, twice in Scripture. Both times, once in the verse we just read, but also the second time in this first epistle of John. You see the word twice, but you see this idea articulated in a myriad of different ways throughout Scripture. And the word propitiation, it comes from the Greek word hilasmos, right? Means an atoning sacrifice, an offering or an appeasement made to satisfy an offended party. I know Justin loves this song. Many of you love this song. We sing it all the time at home. "In Christ alone." "Then on the cross as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied, because Jesus was the propitiation for our sins, and not only ours, but also the sins of the whole world." Doesn't quite sing as well, but that is the reality. The wrath of God was satisfied because he was our propitiation. John Stott says this, "The essence of sin is man substituting himself for God, while the essence of salvation is God substituting himself for man. Man asserts himself against God and puts himself where only God deserves to be, but God sacrifices himself for man and puts himself where only man deserves to be." And this is the amazing thing. Jesus did not just delay the wrath or buffer it or lessen it or somehow divert it for it to come back to us later. Instead, he bore it once and for all so that we did not have to. Praise the Lord. And so where does that leave us this morning, church? I think we all must ask ourselves these questions. As sons and daughters of light, do we recognize our sin? Do we see it for what it is? Do we feel godly sorrow and remorse when we sin? Do we confess our sins? Do we repent and forsake our sin? Do we receive the cleansing available to us by the blood of Jesus? And do we grow each day in our love for God and His commands and our hatred of sin? And church, if we can identify in some way with these things, even if not perfectly, even if not growing by leaps and bounds, even if you're making a mess of it sometimes, that's okay. Take joy in the fact that you are son and daughter of light, and you cannot therefore walk in darkness. Romans 8:1-2. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life has set you free in Christ Jesus from the law of sin and death. Church, there is no longer condemnation for the sons of light. So we have been set free by the work of Christ. And if you don't find yourself in that position today, if you look at your life, if there is something within you that says, that is not a reality in my life, not only am I living my own way, but I'm living in habitual sin, and I'm enjoying my sin, and I don't feel remorse, it's not too late. You'd have to cry out to Him, to humble yourself, to cry out to Him, to repent before Him. He can change your life. He can take you from walking in darkness and make you a son of light. You can enjoy fellowship with Him and with the body of Christ. Please bow your heads and allow me to pray for us this morning. Father, thank you that that is where we are positionally. We are sons and daughters of light, having been taken from darkness. Taken out of our sin, out of our mess. And Father, we are not perfect, and we still transgress against you. And we still grieve your Spirit. But Father, thank you that when we transgress, when we sin, we are faithful to confess our sins before you. We can be cleansed by the blood of Jesus. Thank you that we do have an advocate. That is your Son. What a privilege. Father, let us walk in holiness as sons of light. Not in our own strength. Not in some sort of religious piety like the Pharisees. But let us walk in the light, empowered by your Holy Spirit to look the way that your Son did. We need your help, Father God. Without you, that is not possible. But through you, all things are possible. Holiness is possible. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 Church, God bless you. Hang around for...